Welcome to the Wild West of flow cytometry. Just joking, but not really. Small particle analysis by flow cytometry is still a relatively young field, but it's growing rapidly. So if you're ready to boldly go where many thought a flow cytometer would never go, here are some basic tips to start you on your journey. I will say that I'm not an expert in this field, and I'm learning alongside with you. I have to give a shout out to my colleague Vera Tang, who is one of the leaders in this field and the creative genius behind many of the images you'll see today. Let's dive in. First off, what is small particle flow cytometry and is it really that hard? So when we think about things that run on a flow cytometer, generally we're dealing with cells. When we talk about small particle flow cytometry, we're entering the world of platelets, bacteria, viruses, and extracellular vesicles, things that size, much smaller than a cell. Coming back to, is it really that hard? Yes, it is really more challenging than dealing with cells. When we think about an experiment on a flow cytometer, the first thing we need to consider is the basic protocol. We're not dealing with cells anymore. So you can throw your old protocols out, gone are the days of washing off excess reagent, and also having the rest of that remain end up in the noise. When working in the small particle world, any reagent you add to your samples stays in your samples, generally speaking. And these reagents themselves may also be detected because we're working in that area of the noise, something that we're not used to dealing with cells. So looking at these plots here, all that was added is buffer with antibody. No particles, no cells. And you can see there's a significant amount of PE positive events detected. And that's coming only from the antibodies that are in the solution. So with this in mind, you can see why titration in this scenario is so important. For a more detailed discussion on this, you can check out my chat with Desmond Pink. And along these same lines, you can also imagine why, when doing small particle work, you're going to want a directly conjugated antibody. If you add in a primary and a secondary, you have more things that will be detected, and it can lead to just a world of pain. So after staining, the next thing we need to think about is our flow cytometer, specifically the fluidics of a flow cytometer. Now, most cytometers on the market being used for small particle flow are just a standard flow cytometer. They've been fluidically built around cells, as in the fluidics need to be large enough for standard cells to move through easily. Now, when you put small particles in these fluidics, you have a much higher chance of coincidence. Remember, again, that this is more than one particle passing through the laser simultaneously. But in this case, the changes in forward scatter height and forward scatter area are not going to help you detect or eliminate these events because they're just too small and there's not enough change in those parameters. So you may even end up in the small particle world in a case of extreme coincidence, which is known as swarm. We'll talk about how to detect this shortly, but it's really important to keep in mind when you're running these samples that both your sample source and your reagents will play into coincidence or swarming, as both are going to contribute to the total events your cytometer is seeing. Again, different from cells, when a lot of those events are going to be below your threshold and not seen by the cytometer. So after thinking about our fluidics, we next need to think about detection. In comparison to a small particle, a cell is huge. It's easy to detect. It has lots of markers on its surface. When we're dealing with small particle flow, we're working right at, or maybe even below, the limit of detection for a standard flow cytometer. So detecting small particles relies on a combination of a number of factors, including particle size, or the amount of light it can scatter, the particle refractive index, again, this also plays into the amount of light scattered, the antigen density, because we're dealing with a much smaller surface area than cells, low density antigens may be below the fluorescence limit of detection for the instrument, as in there's not enough of your protein of interest on the surface after it's bound by antibodies to be seen by the cytometer. So for this reason, it's important to use very bright fluorophores, as brighter fluorophores will give you the best chance of finding these events. And finally, you need to think about the instrument configuration and setup. Not all cytometers are created equal, and not all will work well for small particle analysis. So it's important to test this before you really dive into your project. So those are some of the main factors you need to consider when starting a small particle flow experiment. Again, not all of them, just some of the most important ones. It seems a little daunting, doesn't it? I hope I haven't scared you off yet. And don't worry, there is a lot of help out there for you. So when you're starting out, there are two important documents you should take a look at, and I'll link both of them in the description below. So first off, you've heard me talk before about the MyFlowCyte, or the Minimum Information for a Flow Cytometry Experiment document before. Now you get to hear about the MyFlowCyte EV, the Minimum Information for a Flow Cytometry Experiment for Extracellular Vesicles, or just generally small particles. This document, again linked in the comments, is a great outline of the workflow, controls, and methods for small particle work. Next, I would recommend you also check out the recently published Compendium for Small Particle Flow. This short 70-ish page document covers everything you could ever want to know about small particle flow, from the physical characteristics of EVs to the physics behind it all with mean theory to a generic workflow and data reporting requirements. It's an excellent, comprehensive document of the current recommendations in the field. So, for this last section, let's take a look at the controls you'll need in small particle flow. Like all other flow experiments, the success of your experiments depends on your controls. Before, we've talked about the five main classes of controls that you need for a general flow cytometry experiment. Lucky for you, a lot of those show up here as well. However, there are many additional controls that you will need for a small particle experiment. So putting the focus on these, like any other flow cytometry experiment, is really important. So the first control you'll need is a buffer-only control. Again, this is whatever buffer your particles are in and gives you an idea of the background coming from your buffer and your instrument. It's important that you use the same buffer in order to accurately capture the proper background, comparing apples to apples. If your particles are in PBS, using unfiltered water is not going to give you the same background results. The buffer-only control also gives you an idea of where you should set your trigger thresholds, and also to determine if your instrument is even clean enough to start your experiment. After this, you're going to want to run a buffer plus reagents, so the same buffer-only control, but in this sample, you're going to add whatever reagents you've added to your extracellular vesicles. This control will provide you with the signal contributed from the unbound reagents in your sample. Following this, your next control is unstained particles in buffer. Most small particles are not distinguishable from noise without a stain. There are certain circumstances when you may see them, but as a general rule, you will need some sort of fluorescence to pick them up on a cytometer. So this control allows you to determine your background for detecting stained events from unstained. It's kind of like an unstained control. It gives you a reference point for the number of detected events with and without particles, so buffer only versus buffer plus particles. And it will also assist in swarm detection, so a really important control for you to have run. Next control is your standard isotype control, so buffer plus particles plus isotype. Similar to standard flow, these are a protocol control and not used for gating. If you're working with particles that may express FC receptors, this is again going to be a very important control. Following this, we have our single stained and FMO controls. Again, very similar to standard flow, your single stain controls are still used for compensation. However, in addition to this, because of the close proximity of fluorophores on a small particle, there may be some quenching or steric hindrance effects. So these controls also helped you in assessing that. Ideally, what you want to see is your pattern of fully stained samples matches that from your single stained samples and various FMOs, so you know that the antibodies aren't causing any issues when they're together on that small particle. If you do see changes, you may need to play around with the order in which your antibodies are added to reduce some of those effects, or you may not even be able to use them together. So this control will allow you to assess that part. Following this, like standard flow, we have our procedural controls. Now these controls are necessary like in general flow, to ensure your assay has worked, but also to ensure that your protocol hasn't introduced any artifacts into your system that may be detected. Again, more challenging than cells. And just as a side note, if you thought there were a lot of controls in standard flow, small particle flow has a lot more. We're nearing the end of the list, though, I promise. The next controls that you're going to need to run are your serial dilution controls, so taking your stain sample and serially diluting it. This is not your titration, that's separate. This is on your stain sample. So remember earlier when we were talking about swarm detection? Well, these controls are what are going to allow you to determine whether or not you are in swarm. These controls will also allow you to determine the correct concentration for running your samples in order to be in or to avoid swarm detection. We don't want swarming. As you can see in this figure, the samples we're looking at should have a linear decrease in events, so your event rate should go down as you decrease the concentration, and it should have a steady median fluorescence intensity. So when we have swarm, we're not going to see those responding linearly, and that's how we know which regions to avoid. And finally, our last control is the detergent-treated sample. This control allows you to differentiate detergent-sensitive membrane-enclosed particles, such as cells and EVs, from detergent-resistant particles, such as detergent-resistant membrane domains, immune complexes, lipoprotein particles. That's a tricky one to say. They're not a perfect control, but they can help in some cases determine if what you're looking at is or is not a biological particle. It's important to keep in mind that because it's a detergent, it can also form micelles, which can be detected by the instrument, and it itself may introduce some artifacts into your experiment. Hopefully, I haven't left you feeling too overwhelmed here, and hopefully this will give you a head start on any small particle flow projects. We've not yet tackled instrument setup. This will be another topic for a different video. It is a very dense topic in and of itself. A few extra parting words and tips. Number one, titrate, 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 titrate. This is exponentially even more important in small particle flow. Second up, play around with your staining time. A lot of standard cell staining protocols stain for 15 to 30 minutes. This may not be enough for small particles. Many small particle protocols stain for 18 to 24 hours. Number three, your forward scatter and side scatter will need to be in log. This is the only way you have any hope of seeing your particles with scatter. Look at your signals when you're running on height instead of area. This seems to provide some advantages for finding your small particles. Number five, like cells, but again, even more important here, run your cytometer on low. Definitely never, never run on high. Always run on low. It helps you prevent swarming. It decreases your coincidence. Really important for small particle work. And last up, unlike cells, where you're used to acquiring generally for a certain number of events, for small particles, it's recommended you acquire based on a specific amount of time. For example, 60 seconds for each sample. This will help you standardize your results a little bit more, since in the EV world, we generally don't report results as percent positive because there's a lot of noise skewing that percentage. You're going to present your results instead as a concentration or a number of events. So standardizing based on the amount of time helps you standardize that reporting. And finally, good luck on your small particle adventures, and we'll see you in the next one.